To wrap up this morning, I'd like to welcome Barbara Lisicki, who was mentioned several times in Tony's previous presentation. Barbara is one of the pioneers of the disability arts movement, and in fact, the disability movement being part of the Red Action Network. And these two movements were very close, particularly in the 80s and 90s, which she's going to tell you all about, and the massive impact it had on the lives of the 12 million disabled people in this country now. I said at the beginning, we've got a long way to go, but we've certainly come a long way as well, and that upsurge in the 80s and 90s is largely to be thanked for that. So, without more ado, I would like to welcome Barbara Lisicki to tell us about that. Thank you.
Around and there are flats there now, but we printed 500 piss on pity t-shirts. And we thought, see what happens now, what the police going to do about that? And they came up, so they always try and pick off the leaders, and they came up to me and they said, you can't wear that. And I said, well, I'll take it off, but I'm not wearing anything underneath. What would you prefer? Your tits or the slogan? Well, they decided to let me keep it on. So yeah, so we came up with the sort of black and shocking pink colourway, which became sort of iconic. Okay, that's one. Yes. The subsequent t-shirts that we designed, because we managed to get so many people mobilised for the block telephone demonstration. For those of you, some of you are too young to remember telephone, but it was just this hideous fest. And it was a pity fest. And it's basically just 27 hours of vile live television where they just demeaned, belittled, and patronised disabled people. And they said, you know, they were begging for money. And one of our positions was, you're begging for money on our behalf, but you don't have our permission. And that was, you know, that became a really powerful position because all the way through the disability rights movement, we said, you don't have our permission. And later on, we've got another t-shirt that spells that out really loud and clear. This next one, this is for the geeks. Yeah, so do you want to come around this one? Okay. So it's another, our telephone, we formed down the Disabled People's Direct Action Network. And it's basically, we were out on the streets, we were very visible, we were doing non-violent direct action, we were handcuffing ourselves to buses, because one of our first campaigns was for accessible public transport. And so this was one of the first Dan t-shirts, and like I said, it's for the Trekkies, if we've got any Trekkies in, it's Star Trek. And we actually nicked this from the States, because we've been to the States and we've seen how DAC, the Direct Action Organisation in the United States, does their actions. And they have this t-shirt and it says, Disability Rights, the Final Frontier. And the slogan underneath is, to boldly go where all others have gone before. Which is, you know, you like to bring a bit of humour into our shirts. And so that was our first Dan t-shirts, and then it says Rights Now on the bottom. So that was every time, decided every time we had an action, we printed a new t-shirt. And one of the ways in which we marked that is if you, Jill's wondering around that, on the sleeve it actually says where the actions have been. So we got to the point where we filled up on the sleeve, so we started running out of space because we were doing so many actions on the street. So we weren't just in London, we were travelling around different cities. So we went to Christchurch, for example, because there was an MP in Christchurch who was blocking anti-discrimination legislation for disabled people and saying, you know, there's not a problem, we don't need anti-discrimination legislation. Disabled people say, yes, we do. We need a law that protects us. Because, you know, if you get chucked out of cinema, if they decided you were a florist in your wheelchair, you could get chucked out of a cafe with your guide dog because they said we don't allow dogs into places where food is served. And this is just going on daily and consistently, and actually to some extent still does, but a lot less. But, you know, we needed a response to that, and that's what we did with Dan. And we did it very loudly and very visibly. And we made sure that people noticed us, because we believe in that Oscar Wilde maxim, which is, you know, there's nothing worse than not, oh, I can't remember what it is. Who knows that quote? It's about being noticed. Oh, come on, somebody must know it. Anyway, it's basically saying you've got to get noticed. And so we said, look, there's no point in doing actions unless people know that you're doing them. So we went for maximum disruption. And The t-shirts helped with that because they were, you know, they made us visible and it was known that we were part of the movement. So, this one's got a hole because I wear it as a nightshirt. It's got a bit worn out. But anyway, this is a general idea. You'll see there we've got more of the places we went to on the sleeves. But this one says, "We will ride." And again, we went for the black and pink, although it's a bit washed out. And it's got the lightning bolt down the front in pink. And then it says, "Dan, we will ride." With the whole strategically placed. And it was Dan's first campaign because we thought, look, you know, in 1992, 93, we couldn't get on a bus. Disabled people couldn't get on a bus. Wheelchair users, people with mobility impairments, certainly. But also travelling on a bus if you were deaf, if you were visually impaired or blind, but just had, you know, any number of impairments was difficult and a bit of a nightmare. But there was a whole load of people that simply couldn't get on the bus at all. And we said, if you call it a public transport, then make it properly public. And that's when we got into the old handcuffing ourselves to the buses thing. And I'll tell you a little story about that because, again, we start, we will ride from the United States because in the States, ADAPT had had a campaign for accessible transport as well and were effective. And we knew that we could win that. And one of the things about that is that we've got to get a campaign that's going to win. And we did. Oh, sorry, I should have said, yeah, Dan, apart from being a bloke's name, is the Disabled People's Direct Action Network. Yeah. So, and the designs, one of our sort of main key activists was a guy called Andy Gill. And Andy did most of the designs because he was a good artist. And so we came up with the ideas and then Andy designed them. So there's one that I've got to bring, which is Tear Down the Walls, which is Dan Dares, and it's a fist punching through a brick wall, which is again a very familiar image in a lot of movements. And it said Dan Dares and Tear Down the Walls. And that was, you know, we started talking about other things. We were talking about not being able to get on the bus, but then we started talking about all sorts of other barriers that were preventing disabled people from having equality and equal access. And so the Tear Down the Walls captured that. The next one that Jill is going to model for us, we departed from the black and pink and went black and red. And it says, "Nothing about us without us." Now you all know that slogan, right?
Yeah.
And sometimes disabled people try to claim it, but I'm sorry, but it's not ours. We have used it, but actually it comes from the anti-apartheid movement in South Africa, "Nothing about us without us." But again, for those of you that know about apartheid legally made the black majority in South Africa unequal, and basically they were banned by law. They had to sit on the back of the bus. You know, all the stuff that was just outrageous and was still going on during the 1980s. And we said, yes, this is also a slogan that applies to us to disabled people. Because an early slogan of the disability rights movement was "Rights Not Charity." Now there was a Rights Not Charity t-shirt, but God, it was boring. And so I didn't even bother to bring it because it looked like shit. And that's when we thought, this is part of our art. The t-shirts are part of our art. So we need to make them good to look at. We need to put some design into them. And that's what we're trying to do. So on this t-shirt, it says "Nothing about us without us." And Dan, the Dan logo again in the middle. And it's just always large block capitals. And it's a hand, it's a red hand. And it's like a palm print of that hand. and a lot of splattered red paint. And we produced this t-shirt when Dan used to have organised actions at least two a year, but also local actions and snap actions, what we called snap actions. And we had enough of a network to be able to call on maybe 30, 40, 50 people really quickly. And one time, the Labour government got in 1997 after 13 years of Thatcher and the Tories. And we were so thrilled that finally Thatcher was gone, that the Tories were gone, and that many disabled people would finally get some justice. And within a few months, Blair starts announcing cuts to disability benefits. So what we did, a few days before Christmas, we pulled together about 40 or 50 people, and we went down to 10 Downing Street to say hello to Tony Blair. And what we did, it was actually part of my action, although there were again more rests, but we took what looked like little takeaway, meals on wheels, cartons, and so little pack lunches, that's what everybody thought. In fact, they were filled with red paint, which we threw at the doors of 10 Downing Street. Went around the world, it was everywhere, and it captured it in this t-shirt, the splattered red paint, the red palm print, because we put red palm prints all over the pavements and everything, and calling card, so we wouldn't forget who we were. And because, in that sense, Dan is not a part of political, we would basically campaign against anybody who was doing the wrong thing and not supporting disabled people. And although Dan is active at the moment, we still need to keep that principle. And one thing I do want to say, is Dan is being revived. There's been a lot of people saying, we want Dan back. And so it's going to happen. So if anybody wants to know more and wants to get involved in that, you don't have to get arrested, but it's likely you will be. We think it's time we got more visible again. And the thing is, they're having some really great and really dramatic actions. But what we're saying, or my opinion on this, is they need to be frequent and they need to be consistent. Because doing one action once a year doesn't make people remember you. And one of the things that we really wanted to do is be highly visible and be in the press. You have to have media coverage for this stuff. And again, that's what we plan to do. So, it's probably the rest of my career down to I'll live with that. This is one of the final, we departed from the black and pink, but this is, Richard mentioned an artist called Joy Assembly, who was officially a paired artist. And this is one of Joya's images. She gave us permission to use this. And when we won the anti-discrimination legislation and the accessible transport campaigns, we went for a campaign called Free Our People. Now I think it was a bit ahead of its time, but we were talking about the way in which disabled people are removed from society. And a lot of disabled people are still locked away. They're forced to go to places and do things that they don't want to do. And they don't have access to their communities or their societies. So the Free Our People slogan was introduced. And so it was Joya's image. Now Joya's image is because she's visually impaired. She said she worked a lot with light and shade. And I think this is a really effective image. It's just a body image. But, it's sort of with the arms fly upwards. And, that was the last Dan t-shirt of that series. But because we're reviving Dan, there's obviously going to be a new series of t-shirts, so we're also going to be looking for designers. So thanks a lot for listening. Come and talk to me afterwards.
We can go on, say, 10, 15 minutes, but I think people might be hungry and food is out there on the table, including for those people who ask us particular diet to eat. So check the labels before you just take whatever's there. And if it's not labeled, then anybody can take it. But the stuff are gluten-free and vegetarians and so on. So who would like to go first? Anybody want to say something, reflect on what you've heard this morning, make a point, or ask a particular point to anybody? Let me try. Anybody?
Nobody
want to say
anything?
I'll enjoy the t-shirt.
Yeah.
Yeah, this one.
Doing it, but you know, when you stop the traffic in the middle of Parliament Square, and the whole of London's gridlocked, that's going to get noticed. You know, you're even mentioned in the traffic reports. and this stuff has to be very high profile, it has to be very visible, and, you know, people need to be prepared to get arrested, because, you know, look at the other movements, look at the Black Liberation movements, look at the South African anti-apartheid movement, you know, the suffragettes
in Ireland,
absolutely. You know, certainly the first civil rights march through Belfast, you know, certainly because the nationalist population was facing massive discrimination in jobs and housing and all these other things. You know, people needed to get visible because there was anger there, and that anger needed to be captured, but it also needed to be made collective. Because one of the things that I think we've lost in the last few years, which is why looking at our history is so critical, is that we've forgotten that we actually do have a collective identity. And we need to sort of celebrate that identity, but we also need to harvest that anger so we can get out there and show what we're made of, and show the rest of the world that we're not prepared to tolerate what's going on. I mean, we've got a more vicious Tory government now than we've had since the years of Thatcher, and we are being smashed, we are being hammered by this government with all the changes to benefits, the bloody bedroom tax, all the things that we know is going on. And that is not being protested, do you know? People smashed the poll tax in the 90s. Why haven't we smashed the bedroom tax? What is wrong with us? We need to get out there and sort this. And disabled people need to be in the forefront of that, and we will be, as long as everybody in this room is going to join up to do it.
A couple of points, and I think it's really important to recognise that consciousness of raising awareness, and certainly there are striking parallels with other social movements. One of the struggles that I'm constantly in is the questions around how do we reintroduce or, you know, revisit and revitalise our histories through education, because we're constantly finding ourselves being written out of our curriculums. And so therefore, there's hidden generations time and time again, and whilst direct action and other kinds of civil protests are important, it's part of the story, it's not the full story, it's part of the disability arts in terms of people breaking through. We probably have fantastic artists who can't even get onto courses, to dream about their aspiration, because we're constantly segregating individuals. And I think what we need to do is work out a strategy, work out, you know, structural change, and campaign for enforced civil rights and protective measures that other social groups get that disabled people do not. And there's something troubling me and also many other people around the way with higher education, which has been mentioned already. Disabled people are written out of the very, you know, changes in DSA, disabled students' allowance, of preventing certain people from getting into higher education to become budding artists, to become politically active, you know, within the National Union of Students movement. And there's something deeply disturbing about our society that segregates us all in some respects. So just some reflective points.
We go over there, there's two over there, and then one there. Can I just comment on that? There is a conference in this very hall in 2 weeks' time to rebuild the disability movement, both from the trade unions and various disability organisations. People want to get into that, come along in 2 weeks' time here, because I think it's very important, very timely. This conference is not about that, though obviously there's an interaction. I want to ask Barbara before we finish to say a little bit more about the interaction between the action and the culture that's going on at the same time, because I think that is also very important. Over to you, please.
Hi, Christina Payne from ECU. I just have to respond to what the gentleman there just said about training arts, because actually I think it's not just a disabled issue, it's, I think it's a class issue, and the same happens with
Christina. You get to hold it closer.
The same happens in the theatre and acting. Well, so we need to consider the two together, because the
people who are, the class issue is that money to train, reason, and access to it as well. But I also wanted to respond to the point about the, what the name of the lady in the t-shirts. I wasn't clear what you were saying, because I'm a member of DPAT myself, and DPAT are famous for doing action in the road and changing themselves to us as a community. So I just wasn't quite clear what you were saying. It seems to me that we do it to work together to have a more better approach. And I think that's what you're saying, but I just wanted to make it clear. And then I have one more question, which is sort of for the swearing in the name, the gentleman who did the art competition at the beginning. That's absolutely fantastic. But what I'm wondering is there evidence of much more BME representation, disabled representation in art? Because it seems to me that a lot of the people that we were seeing in the pictures were male, mostly, but not all.
And
I wonder if that's correct.
I searched for women and I put up quite a few of those at the end. The problem, when I said at that point, I think we need more research, but BME in the European culture, not very obvious at all. If people have got other people, we're happy to include them. I put out, this is the beginning of this month, we're not even in the month, so if anybody's got any other examples, please email me, and I will be doing more presentations to totally have all balance. But that's the reality of what's there in the public realm.
Thank you. It wasn't meant for this criticism. I think your presentation was amazing. I was just wondering about the end of the presentation.
Well, let's take the other one, because otherwise, and then we can round up and have lunch. So, there's two more, and that's all I'll take. There's more time at the end for discussion.
Esther from UKDHM, I'm just doing disability studies. And just on the second point you made, I do agree with that. But also, just listening to what you were saying about the history of disability movement in this country and where we are now, do you think that in the 80s and in the 90s you were able to achieve a lot more because you had one united voice? But I guess as an issue got more complex, different disability organisations began to set up and had different focuses, and so now it's become fragmented where there are many voices.
Of one thing, so there's less impact now. And so, what do you think about that? And what do you think about bringing all these different organisations together? What are the organisations you work with to try and have one connected voice for disability movements?
Well, we'll come over and take Sarah, but I'll react and then I'll give it to Barbara to finish up.
Well, that's what the conference in 2 weeks is about, to try and bring one movement together out of fragments. But there were splits in the 90s, the main big charities went off with Rights Now, who were prepared to accept what was being offered in the Disability Discrimination Act, where most of us were not, because it wasn't comprehensive civil rights legislation. It took 150 amendments from the Labour government to get anywhere near that, and we still haven't. I don't think that people will split when there are political issues. It's the political issues that they split over, not other things. That's why it's important to have a united programme when you do come together. Hopefully that will be starting for us now, the meeting here on the 4th of November.
What's it called?
National Disabled People's Summit. Action.
National Disabled People's Summit. If you search on the web for that, you'll find a way to book your ticket. It's on Eventbrite, I think.
It's so thrilling.
There was a lot in what you asked, so I'm going to try and sort of keep it brief.
It's just a question, please.
Okay, we want to wrap up the morning session.
Okay. that I would say that's happened in the last 10 years is that disabled people's organisations have basically suffered massive cuts in funding, as have loads of other organisations. I mean, the whole third sector has collapsed in on itself because the Tories have cut the funding. There is so little public funding out there, and everybody's squabbling over the same tiny pot of money. And one thing that I can tell you about BAM, Disabled People's Direct Action Network, is that we never had a penny from any public source whatsoever. Basically, we fundraised and we spent our own money. Everything I owned for 10 years went into that, which was fine because it was needed. But what I would say is that, you know, maybe we need to be more imaginative about how we start bringing funding in. And I know people are doing crowdfunding and stuff like that, which is better. But I think one of the problems is that disabled people's movement dissipated and disappeared because the funding disappeared. And we can't allow that to happen. And so I think what we need to do is just get them, sort out ways of getting ourselves together. Look at who's out there who can provide the support and some kind of structure, but not be dependent on it. And so that we can be effective without that in some way. And find out who our allies are. You know, they can get, let us use their resources, like spaces like this. The street is free, so you can get out on the street and it doesn't cost you anything. You know, you sell the t-shirts eventually. If anybody wants to buck some money, you know, we found places that would loan the money to get paid. There are always ways. And I think that's what I would say about artists and disability arts. When disability arts first started, like there were some people, and it was disabled artists started to come together and talk to each other. I almost made a living as a stand-up for 10 years, doing gigs all over Europe and the States and around the UK, because of the disability arts movement. And I've got to say thanks for that. I would have never have done it unless there had been a movement, and I've been able to. My first audience was a bunch of disabled people, and they thought what I was saying was funny. I can't get it, not disabled people do, because they have no sense of humour. But I think it's time, and I think we've got the appetite to start drawing some of the themes that we were working on, and the themes that the issues that we've got now. We need to start bringing that back together, find focus. If we try and do too many things, we will dissipate again. We need to find our focus, and that includes artists, it includes activists, it includes people that have never been on a demo in their lives. Because we've got to get this done, and we've got to get these bastards out of government.
Everybody gets a chance, all right? So we'll look.